Hallelujah.
Amen.
It's good to be here again.
Amen.
Thank you, B, as always, for a wonderful worship experience in music. And thank you for all our sound techs and audio techs we have here, Buster Miles, for helping make all this possible. Amen. I mean, really. So if we would, if you are on Facebook or you saw this come up, seeing beyond your religion, seeing people as people, not a theological doctrine. Recently, I had the privilege of attending a kickoff midweek worship service of a couple of pastor friends of ours here in LA with several of our church leaders. The guest pastor they had teaching that evening was a fellow by the name of Stan Mitchell, who did a spectacular job in communicating some profound truths in a simple fashion. Some of the things that he shared were things we've shared here before, and me so in other places, but I really felt like it was take a couple of parts of the things he shared at the beginning and connect them to some of the things that God has shared with us and present them to you today. So some of this you may have heard a couple of years ago, just bits of it, but putting it together I think would be quite helpful. With that in mind, let's have a quick word of prayer. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you that the Holy Spirit is our teacher. And God, I pray that we allow the Spirit to speak to our hearts today. God, I want to thank you that you promised us that we're already seated in heavenly places in Christ, and you speak to us from that level so we can manifest you, the living Christ, here in this earth. So thank you, Lord, for us putting aside our preconceived ideas, our egoistic religiosity that sometimes likes to creep in, that inner Pharisee that tries to rise up, and God, that we can hear what you are saying to us in a very foundational way. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
The title I felt that was appropriate was Seeing Beyond Your Religion, Seeing People as People, Not a Theological Doctrine. Let's get straight to the point. The greatest threat to living a Christ-like life, or as some would say, the greatest threat to Christianity, is not other religions, or some form of occultic practices that have crept into the church, siding with a particular political party, or some cabal against the Christian faith in a nation. It's the Christian religion itself.
Wow.
Just like approximately 2,000 years ago when Jesus arrived on the scene, the Hebrew people who were supposedly given the oracles of God in the form of what they called the Torah, or literally the Tanakh, if you want to use a proper name, their supposed deep study and adherence to those scriptures, what they called the Word of God, brought them to a place of dedicated worship to an empty temple, void of the presence of God, an intimate relationship with the very paganism they believed they were to avoid, and most importantly, because of their so-called scriptural accuracy, they couldn't recognize the Christ when he appeared, all to the point of violence and crucifying him in the name of preserving their version of truth. I'm going to suggest to you, in certain respects, we're no different. It wasn't just Pharisaical Jewish people that had this problem. All religious systems have this problem, including ours. The posture of theological, scriptural, and moral correctness is what veils our eyes and hearts from the presence of the living Christ within us. It will substitute prophecy, miracles, and deliverance in the charismatic world as the validation of their correctness and maturity. And for biblical literalists, some we call evangelicals or fundamentalists, which is not exactly the same thing, though there's a large overlap, who use the New Testament as a revised constitution of the Old Testament as a validation for their biblical worldview. Today, I want to share with you three examples from the New Testament that openly show us the very opposite. These examples unveil the reality of Christ and how sometimes in the line between the two opposites, though it can appear very thin, is actually a huge gulf between the two, more like the Grand Canyon. Let's first have a look at the events revolving around the man who was born blind and the discussion between Jesus and his disciples. A very powerful segment here. It reads, this is out of the New American Standard, "As he passed by, he saw a blind man from birth. And his disciples asked him, 'Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?' And Jesus answered, 'It was neither that this man was sinned nor his parents, but it's that so the works of God might be displayed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me as long as it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world.' When he had said this, he spat on the ground, made clay of the spittle, applied the clay to his eyes and said to him, 'Go and wash in the pool of Siloam,' which is translated sent. So he went away, washed, and came back seeing." Now, as we read these verses, this picture of a blind man, obviously it was not a depiction of somebody in actual Jesus day.
Right.
You know, he's dressed in modern clothes, but he still is in a blind situation.
Right.
Now, notice this very first important thing. Jesus saw a blind man.
Right.
But more so, Jesus saw a man.
Yeah.
And what's interesting about that phrase, literally, it's eidon anthropon in Greek, which literally is, he saw a human being.
Wow.
He saw a person.
Yes. Yes.
The living word, the eternal Christ, saw a person. That's profound and important. On the other hand, these scripturally dedicated religious people didn't see a human being, though if you asked them, they would have said, sure, he's a human being, but they saw a theological and doctrinal situation. Who sinned, this man or his parents? Think of it. At this point, this person is sitting in the acceptable beggar's posture to receive alms from whoever will, which was the culturally and religiously acceptable thing to do, particularly of his day. And he's having to listen to the disciples pose a supposed theologically correct question about his situation: who did the sin? Think of what that's like for a minute. Right away, the sense of religious and self-righteous superiority starts to appear. Keep in mind, while taking care of such people were part of the religious practice of that day, right, to give them donations, you can tell who really felt good about it. The beggar, who is in the situation because of some sin, quote unquote, and the so-called merciful, righteous, religious people who gave to him because they get to be kind and feel good about it. Mm-hmm. Let me add something to this. Remember how Jesus said, eidon anthropon? Mm-hmm. He saw a human being. You know what the disciples said? By the way, anthropon is a direct reference to the image and likeness of God. So Jesus didn't just see a human being, though he did. He didn't just see a person. He saw what a true human being and a person is, the image and likeness of his Father. When the disciples posed the questions, they didn't say that. They said, "Tis harmaiton houtos." Who sinned? This one? This guy? Or his parents?
Wow.
Forgive my Greek pronunciation there. They didn't see a human being. They didn't see a person. They most definitely didn't see the image and likeness of God. They saw their theology.
Right.
They saw their doctrine. And because of it, they saw sin and a sinner. Surely they couldn't see the image and likeness of God. After all, if you're in sin, there can't be a real resemblance of the image and likeness of God present.
Right.
In the message I heard a few weeks ago, Pastor Mitchell said something profound and yet so simple. There is no right answer to a wrong question.
Wow.
The disciples were asking the wrong question.
Right.
Who sinned? Now, we can point to chapter and verse in the Old Testament as to why the question was posed. In the true economy of God, however, the question has no relevance. Whether he was conceived in some adulterous situation or his parents committed some sin and its consequence was passed on to him, there's verses you can play with for that, or he did some vile thing in a previous life, all was irrelevant. Jesus said, neither. None of the above. Now, as we'll find in further situations, the religiousness of the disciples will just add the new information rather than yet seeing what Jesus saw. How many times we hear people say things like, well, we live in a fallen, sinful world, so things happen.
Right.
It becomes a convenient theological statement because if we have something happen to us, we get to say, it's the sinful world we live in, or the devil is attacking me. However, when it happens to someone else, we get to add, well, if they didn't do this or that, that may not have happened. In other words, it was some sin that was committed, and that's why it happened. Unless it's maybe a good friend, then it's we live in a sinful world. However, Jesus resets the playing field. He says neither. In other words, sin is not an issue, period. To say that another way would be, you're not a sinner. Let's not talk about it from that point of view.
Right.
Consider this. It's not behavior or some outside forces or someone else's sinful behavior upon them, like his parents in his case. Actually, what we're saying is it's the judgment of God, aren't we?
Yeah.
It's the judgment of God, or by extension, what God allowed, or the work of God, and it's the work of God that is visiting this sinfulness with condemnation and calamity. But Jesus says the opposite. Sin is not an issue. We are to work the works of God. That is not the work of God. We're to work the works of God.
Right.
Your question is proposing that that is the work of God.
Yeah. Right.
And, of course, we modify it. Well, it's not the work of God. It's the work of the devil. But if he didn't sin, God would have allowed it, so the devil wouldn't come in. Step away from the Bible before you hurt yourself and somebody else.
Oh, yeah.
Whew. What you disciples are asking has nothing to do with the work of God. We must work the works of God, which is ultimately healing why the man is really blind. Because this story is a bit broader than just about a guy that can't see. He's saying, what you think the word of God says isn't the issue. For example, Jesus does this repeatedly. You have heard that it is said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, mm-hmm. Jesus totally usurps scripture at this point.
Right.
Love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those that hate you, pray for those that despitefully use you and persecute you, that you may be the sons of your Father in heaven. Consider what Jesus does to the legalistic use of scripture. He is directly addressing Leviticus 19:18, which is the good religious people of the day were connecting to Deuteronomy 25:17, which tells us not to forget what the enemy has done to you. Coupling that with Psalms 41:10, which tells us we can actually repay our enemies for what wrong they have done to us. Wow. And then there's Psalms 139:22, which tells us we can hate with a perfect hatred.
Wow.
Yet Jesus changes the status, but I say to you, and punitive, condemning judgment is not the work of my Father. Jesus the Son of Man, Anthropos, is usurping Old Testament scripture in that one statement. Now, let's not forget, when the disciples were hungry, they plucked heads of grain on the Sabbath. And Jesus, his response to the accusation of the Pharisees were, the Son of Man is Lord of the Sabbath. Wait, they were picking.
Right.
Who's the Son of Man?
Right.
Who's the Son of Anthropos? Who's the Son, the image and likeness of God? Which means you're greater than the Sabbath.
Yeah.
And even legalistic scripture. There is a dynamic of living in the realm of the true identity of Christ, and it's no longer under the rule of that kind of thinking. The Apostle Paul says it this way, quote, the weak and beggarly elements which keep us in bondage. Galatians 4:9. Then there's this situation. Now an angel of the Lord spoke to Philip, saying, rise and go toward the south along the road which goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. So he arose and went. Behold, a man of Ethiopia, a eunuch of great authority under Candace, the queen of the Ethiopians, had come to Jerusalem to worship. Was returning. Sitting in his chariot, he was reading Isaiah. The Spirit said to Philip, go near and overtake his chariot. So Philip ran and heard him read Isaiah and said, do you understand what you're reading? And he said, how can I unless someone guides me? And he asked Philip to come up and sit with him. The place in the scripture which he read was, he was led as sheep to the slaughter, as a lamb before his shearer is silent. So the eunuch said, notice the emphasis, so the eunuch said, not the Ethiopian.
Right.
So the eunuch said, I ask you, of whom does the prophet say this, of himself or some other man? Then Philip preached Jesus to him. Now when they came to some water, and the eunuch said, see, here is water. What hinders me from being baptized? Then Philip said, if you believe with all your heart, you may. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Now, it doesn't stop there. Consider what we just read. There is an Ethiopian eunuch who desired God and worshiped him in the holy city.
Right.
He was reading the scriptures in Isaiah, particularly 53, verse 7, wanting to know the meaning because they had a particular emphasis regarding him.
Right.
Why? Because the scripture is very clear. Let me read something to you. Leviticus 21, 16 through 22. And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to Aaron, saying, no man of your descendants in succeeding generations who has any defect may approach to offer the bread of his God. For any man who has a defect shall not approach. A blind man, a lame man, or eczema, or scab, or is a eunuch. No man of the descendants of Aaron, priest, has a defect, shall come near to offer the offerings made by fire to the Lord. He has a defect. He shall not come near to offer the bread of his God.
Right.
Well, okay, you say, well, he's just talking about priests. No, not really. Let's go to Deuteronomy because that came before. Deuteronomy 23:1. He that is a eunuch, whether he has been crushed or cut, shall not come into the congregation of Jehovah. And what the Holy Spirit just said was, go talk to that eunuch.
Right.
He is desirous of the things of God.
Right.
Go talk to him. And what does he do? He actually baptizes him.
Yeah.
He brings him right into the presence of God, despite Leviticus and despite Deuteronomy.
Yeah.
Because there's a greater one here than those beggarly elements.
Yeah.
You can just change this if you like. How about adding LGBTQ+?
Yeah.
Doesn't matter your condition.
Right.
The gay marriage issues, these become theological discussions rather than about human beings.
Amen.
And I just went through this when I was in the UK with couple of folks in their church. Man, they right away, they go right to Leviticus about some of those issues. Why?
Right.
If Jesus is not going to abide by it, why are you?
Yeah. We're not even of that priesthood.
Exactly. Well, that's a whole other issue. We're not of that priesthood. We're of the Melchizedekian priesthood, which doesn't have rules.
Right.
The Melchizedekian priesthood's rule is love.
It's love.
What does that look like? How about this situation? Take it. The preaching of Jesus, which contains the good news, the eternal gospel, the living Christ, usurps the serpentine legalism of the law. Why is this important? What was the significance about those who were deemed unworthy to enter the presence of God based on the tree of knowledge of good and evil? Because there was a promise given to such people that is astounding, because everything in the promise is contrary to Deuteronomy and Leviticus. Isaiah 53 becomes a foundation for Isaiah chapter 56. It tells us this rather powerful truth. Let no foreigner who has bound himself to the Lord say, the Lord will surely exclude me from his people. Let no foreigner.
Right.
Well, that's contrary to the so-called covenant we once heard in Israel.
Yeah.
Number two, and let not any eunuch complain, I am only a dry tree. And there's a reference to not being able to produce seed, okay? For this is what the Lord says to the eunuchs, directly to them, to the eunuchs. So you may not be a eunuch like that. Maybe you're some other outcast according to some religion. To the eunuchs who keep my Sabbaths and who choose what pleases me and hold fast to my covenant, to them, listen, I will give within my temple. Remember, they weren't supposed to even go in. I will give within my temple and within its walls a memorial and a name better than sons and daughters. I will give them an everlasting name, and here's the pun, that will not be cut off. That's completely directly opposite. No wonder why this eunuch was reading these scriptures. He knew of a promise. He's reading Isaiah 53. He knew of 56. But everything that religious system was telling him, saying, you're not accepted because you're this.
Right.
How many of us have said to folks, you're not accepted because of this?
It's our judgment.
Yeah.
But it doesn't stop there. Acts 10. A man named Cornelius, a centurion, he and all his family were devout and God-fearing. Now, for what it's worth, some of the things the reason the dots are there is because this was getting to be a really long piece of scripture. Do go back and read it. You'll find that the context is still the same. He and all his family were devout and God-fearing. And about 3 PM, he had a vision. He saw an angel of God who came to him and said, Cornelius, your prayers and gifts to the poor have come up as a memorial before God. Now send men to Joppa to bring back a man named Simon, who's called Peter. He is staying with the tanner, whose house is by the sea. Cornelius called 2 of his servants and a devout soldier. That's 3. And sent them to Joppa. About noon the following day, as they were on their journey and approaching their city, Peter went up on the roof to pray. He became hungry and wanted something to eat. And while the meal was being prepared, he fell into a trance. He saw heaven open and something like a large sheet being let down. It contained all kinds of four-footed animals, as well as reptiles and birds. Then a voice told him, Peter, what? Get up, Peter, kill and eat. Surely not, Lord, Peter replied. I've never eaten anything impure or unclean, because that's what the Bible tells me.
Right.
The voice spoke to him a second time. Do not call anything impure that God has made clean. This happened 3 times. Why? Because there's 3 guys coming. That's unclean.
Yeah.
By definition. While Peter was wondering about the meaning of the vision, the men sent by Cornelius found out where Simon's house was, and they called out. He's trying to think of, what does this mean? And the meaning just calls out to him. Right. While Peter was still thinking about the vision, the Spirit said to him, Simon, three men are looking for you, so get up and go downstairs. Do not hesitate to go with them, for I have sent them. Consider, God is sending Gentiles to Peter.
Right.
Why? Why couldn't Peter hear from God to go to them? Because his own theology would have gotten in the way. Because we see it happen here. How many of us, our own theology gets in the way of seeing people as people and doing God's bidding because we have all these rules and lines up in front, and that tells us that can't be so, or I can't do this, or touch not the unclean thing. I may get the spiritual cooties, all those kinds of things, right? Watch. Then Peter invited the men into the house to be his guests. The next day, Peter started out with them. Cornelius was expecting them, and as Peter entered the house, Cornelius met him and fell at his feet in reverence. But Peter made him get up. Stand up, he said. I am only a man myself. Talking with him, Peter went inside and found a large gathering of people. And Peter's being honest. He says to them, you are all aware that it's against our law for a Jew to associate with a Gentile or visit him. But God showed me.
Yay.
So God showed me something contrary to the law. God showed me something contrary to Deuteronomy, Leviticus. Let's go down the list. And so you know what, folks? We're going to have to realize God's going to show you things that are going to be contrary to what you think the New Testament says. I'm not saying the New Testament doesn't say something. I'm saying what we've been taught or what we've been told the New Testament says. Rush ahead real quick. It's not in this, technically in this teaching, but might as well go ahead and make the point. Romans chapter 1 has been one of the, what I call, beat over your head scriptures for the gay community about, you know, how wrong they are and they're worthy of death and all this stuff. And actually I've heard, I've played it for you, a mega preacher in an audience of several thousand people talked about they are worthy of death. But here's the point. You know what the ultimate landing ground of what all those things, because Paul goes through a list of what all, these are all the things that religious folk get upset with, lists them. Right. By the way, some of them are just backbiting,
right,
evil speaking. It's all in the same category,
right.
Okay? But then you know where he ends? Romans 2.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
You who judge them are no better. But we do judge, don't we? We take our theology, like the disciples, they were already judging. There had to be some sin that put this man in this situation. I couldn't see a human being. I couldn't see a person. And Jesus is overthrowing the apple cart there. He overdid it with there. The Holy Spirit did it. We just saw it just a few minutes ago in Acts. And the Holy Spirit is doing it again here. Consider the Holy Spirit and what the Spirit is doing. But God has shown me that I shall not call any man impure or unclean. Any man. They didn't receive Jesus yet. They didn't say a sinner's prayer. They didn't get filled with the Holy Spirit yet and speak in tongues, though that's pending. Peter said, God had to show me. By the way, if you continue to reading the text, which is kind of funny, Peter said that how easily God showed him this. No, he had to beat you over the head three times with a sheet to get it through you. But God has showed me that I should not call any man impure or unclean. You walk out those doors, we're going to see, you will meet all kinds of people. Some which are, we can say, is not really nice. But God still considers them pure and clean. Because he sees through the Christ. And you are the Christ, so you should see with the same eyes. Oh, no, no, no. They're not pure and clean until they receive Jesus in your heart. No, sorry. That didn't happen in all three cases. Especially with the man born blind. Matter of fact, you keep reading that chapter, he didn't even know who healed him.
He didn't see him, but he could see.
He didn't even know.
Yeah.
The Pharisees come to him and say, you know, hey, what's wrong with you? Well, a man came and healed me. What man? I don't know, he says. All I know, I was blind and now I see. Which now tells you, Jesus is touching lives and things are happening. And we're like the Pharisees sometimes saying, well, that can't really be your experience because you didn't know. Because that's what the Pharisees did. Yes, yes, you are blind and now you see, but that's not really what happened.
So what happened? Tell me what happened. I see now.
Yeah, right. You know, go back a few chapters here in Acts. What about the Ethiopian?
Right.
How does he come back? Mind you, Christianity is not like some big time religious system yet.
Right.
Some cases wish it wasn't.
Yeah.
But how do you deal? How does he? I'm in the presence of God now.
Yeah.
Holy Spirit's all over me.
Yeah.
That tells me that's not supposed to be so.
How does he even have the...
Can you imagine all the people around him? Maybe even other eunuchs. No.
Yeah.
That never happened to you.
Right.
No, look, you don't understand. This is really nuts. The guy went in the water with me, and when I came up, I was by myself.
Yeah, exactly.
He was translated somewhere else. This is a total miracle. No, no, because the Word of God says.
Right.
But God has shown me that I should not call any man impure or unclean. After Peter had this rather controversial vision, which he first objects to, he hears the Holy Spirit say, don't hesitate. We've been taught to fear sin. And God's saying, don't hesitate, it can't touch you. What about the sinner? According to Jesus, it's not the problem. The fact that you see them that way is the problem. Consider. All three of these situations, whether it was the Gentile Cornelius, who shouldn't have been visited, the Ethiopian eunuch, who should have never entered the presence of God, or the blind man, who either he or his parents had committed some vile sin, in each case, the true gospel of Jesus Christ presses us to see beyond our self-righteous religiousness, our doctrinal correctness, and legalistic moralism, be it Jewish or Christian, and see the human being, the person, the image of God. Whether their conduct or a point of view sees themselves that way is irrelevant. Jesus takes us beyond the law or biblical legalism or fundamentalism, whatever you want to call it, beyond a superficial or literal view of the scripture, and most importantly, our egoistic satisfaction that comes from obedience to moralistic holiness. Rather, Jesus tells us that human beings aren't doctrinal equations, nor theological positions. To view them as sinners, irrespective of their situation, is not working the works of God, but a wrong question that will never yield a right answer. After all, the notion of right and wrong is the serpent's tree anyway. So to wind this up, in all three of these cases, which is really a foundational bed, which is how, again, how we read. Do we read with the Jesus hermeneutic, or do we read through our egoistic, legalistic rightness, not righteousness, rightness point of view? In all three of these cases, what we would call the law or scripture at the time, New Testament technically wasn't written yet, were all defied. And it's probably a very good reason why It would not be till 30 years after the resurrection the first epistle would be written. And what's interesting, that epistle talks about don't get religious. But we can take anything. We can take the notion of any form of Scripture, even the New Testament, and make it a constitution, rather than a pointer to the living Christ within you. And living your life as a revelation of the Son of God, the Son of Man, which, guess what, can even pick corn on the Sabbath. And that's just one thing. We can go down a whole list. My appeal to you is to see beyond our religion. And when I say that, nobody is excluded. There all comes a point where we have certain liberties, we see certain things, but then all of a sudden there's a border, boom, we hit. I'm not going to cross that. Well, because if I do, my ego will have to die further. I'll have to discover another depth of humility. I'll have to discover a new dimension of resurrection power. That's already living in us. It's already there. See, when I'm talking about resurrection power, I'm not talking about when you physically die getting back up. I'm talking about the harder thing. Letting go of that ego and living beyond it. So today, in very simple terms, when we walk out these doors, or you leave your home today or tonight, depending upon where you are in the world listening to this, see people as people. See them as the image and likeness of God, irrespective of their behavior. And let's not demean this into, well, what if they do this? Well, what if they do that? Let's grow up. Let's grow up. I mean, Jesus told us to turn the other cheek. He didn't say hit him back.
Right.
Father, in Jesus' name, we are the Son of Man. Mm-hmm. We are an emanation of the living Christ. Christ is within us, the hope of glory. Father, may we finally yield to that and see people with our true eyes, which emanate your eyes, which doesn't judge because there is no judgment to wield. That when he sees a person, or we see a person in a situation that our religion, Christian or not, may have said, well, they're probably in that situation because. Instead, we see them as people. And not just simply because we live in a sinful world, but we see them as we need to work the works of God and elevate them, empower them with their true identity. In Jesus' name, amen. With that last point, consider what Jesus did. He spit on the ground, made some clay. In Hebrew, it's the word ha'adama in the Hebrew New Testament. He took of the very substance the Adam was created from, anointed his eyes, and then told him to go to the pool of Siloam, which is the pool of one who sent. You see, up until this point, this blind man is another metaphor here. He was blind because other people saw him as a blind, sinful man. You're in that situation because you're blind. Jesus says, I don't care what anybody is saying. You can see, get up and walk. Go wash. You go wash in the pool of sin. Now you're a man with purpose now. Others have defined your purpose. Others have defined for you who you are and what your status is in life. But I say to you, go wash those eyes. You have purpose. Amen?